Good morning, good morning. Welcome to the River of God broadcast. We are so honored that you wanted to be with us on this morning. Thank God for you. I'm sorry. Hallelujah. We thank God for you wanting to be here and do what God has called you to do in this hour. We just bless God for you. We bless God that he's been great, mighty, powerful, and wonderful in our lives. Good morning again. And as we get started this morning, please turn it down. As we get started this morning, scripture is coming from Psalms 112. And we're going to start in the 7th verse. And while you're gathering, and I'm gathering too, I'm going to sing a song that says, praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun unto the going down of the unseen, oh God. God, some experienced some things they didn't want to experience, oh God, but you brought them through it, oh God, or you're bringing them through it now, oh God. So God, we thank you for this opportunity, God, to come into this house of worship, to praise thy name, to lift thy name up, to glorify you, oh God. And Father God, on behalf of others, and some of those that can't speak, God, we want to apologize. We want to repent, God, this morning for not doing or going to some of the places or doing some of the things that you called us to do. So God, we ask for your forgiveness on this morning, oh God. And we thank you for that forgiveness. Now, God, we ask you to continue to rest, rule, and abide in this place. Rest, rule, and abide in various houses of worship across this nation and around the world. Bless the hearers, oh God, and especially bless the doers of your word, oh God. So, God, we thank you again for this opportunity to come into your house. Lift up thy name and praise your holy name. We love you, God. We love you for what you did yesterday, oh God. We love you for what you're doing today, oh God. And we love you especially for what you're doing for our many tomorrows. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Indeed, this morning, scripture reading is coming from Psalms 112. Psalms 112, and please, when you have it, recognize it by saying amen.
Amen.
You get enough amen so far. Psalms 112 and 9, Psalm 112, starting at verse 7. And it reads as thus, he shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord.
His heart is established. He shall not be afraid until he see his desires upon his enemy.
And the 9th verse together. He has dispersed, he hath given to the poor, his righteousness endureth forever, his horn shall be exalted with honor. Boasting in and of itself is God's precious, mighty, and holy word. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let us continue further with praise and worship.
Let's go! Get up and live. Get up and live. Get up and live. Father, we thank you and praise you. We glorify you once again for thou being our God, our Savior, for this week, for your goodness and your mercy, your righteousness, your holiness. We are appreciating you this morning, God, for you alone are worthy of all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. God, we say good morning to you today. How are you doing, Lord? How may we be of service to your kingdom today? God, we ask now that your word come forth with demonstration and power. Let us glorify you this morning, O God. Let us not leave you the same, but change in Jesus' name. Let the words of our mouth, God, and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. Good morning. Get your Bibles in your hand this morning. Pray that you've had a great, blessed, and prosperous week. We had our state AIM convention and had a wonderful time here in Richmond. And thank God for those in charge and our bishop and Ellie Willis II and all of his cabinet. And thank God for missionary Tiffany Willis that was over our AIM and did a wonderful job, and all the youth and everyone else bringing it all together. God was good to us and continues to be a blessing to us. Amen. 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 Turn that one down right there for me, son, please. Put your Bibles in your hands and repeat after me. Say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
It is a divine word of God.
Is it a divine word of God?
By God's word.
By God's word.
I am empowered. To live in righteousness.
To live in righteousness.
And to walk in holiness.
And to walk in holiness.
By God's word.
By God's word.
I am empowered. To have a renewed.
To have a renewed.
And change mind.
And change mind.
By God's word.
By God's word.
I am empowered. To walk by faith.
To walk by faith.
And not by sight.
And not by sight.
By God's word.
By God's word.
I am empowered.
To be healed.
To be healed. And to walk in divine health.
And to walk in divine health.
By God's word.
By God's word.
I am empowered. To walk in victory.
To walk in victory.
And not in defeat.
And not in defeat.
By God's word.
By God's word.
I am empowered. To walk in love.
To walk in love.
And not in selfishness.
And not in selfishness.
By God's word.
By God's word.
I am empowered. To walk in divine prosperity.
To walk in divine prosperity.
I am.
What God's word.
Says I am.
Says I am.
I will say. Every day. What God's word.
Says I am. Says I am.
I will tell others. What God's word.
God's word.
Says I am. Because I am.
Because I am.
Because I am.
Because I am. Because I am.
What God's word.
God's word.
Says I am.
Says I am.
Hallelujah. Tell the Lord thank you.
Thank you.
I want to tell you, you don't have an identity crisis. You have a crisis of not knowing where to find your identity.
Amen.
For your identity is found in the word of God. For in the word of God, you will find the truth and not just what is true. You may take your seats this morning. I want to preach over the next several weeks. I want to preach. Now, I always preach Bible, but I want to preach. I really don't have a quote-unquote title for a series or something. Maybe the Lord will give me something as we go along. God bless you in that. Pray you had a blessed week. But I want to talk about finding your security in the Word of God. Finding your security in the Word of God. We can't trust in man. Bible says, put not that confidence in man. Why? Because he is man. He's going to let you down. The best of us, and I said us, includes me too, are going to let you down. We're not going to be able to meet all of your expectations of us because we're human and we're fallible.
Yeah.
Don't put your confidence in money because the dollar is up today and it's down tomorrow.
Yeah.
Oh, you're switching to crypto. Crypto is good today and then it's crippled tomorrow. Oh, you invested in stocks. And the stock market, if you really look at it, would make you seasick sitting on your couch in your living room.
Yes.
But within the pages of Scripture, we can find in the Word of God safety and security that will give us confidence, hope, joy, peace, love, and allow us to keep moving forward in this life. I come to tell you there's safety in the Word of God.
Thank you.
There's peace in the Word of God. There's hope in the Word of God. So many people have been hoping in man and in governments, and there's a large segment of the Christian community that says now God is going to turn around and bless America because Roe versus Wade has been overturned and this, that, and the other. Yeah, don't fool yourself. Sin is still sin. Because if you are the same one that says abortion is a sin, but yet you lie, cheat, and steal, and don't count that as a sin, God says it's equal. And so the blessings of God are upon the people of God. Let me say that again. The blessings of God are upon the people of God that live in the kingdom of God. Not in the kingdom of the United States of America. Because if that was the case, that God is going to bless America in spite of Americans that don't line up. But God will bless his people in the midst of other people. We saw it in Israel. Israel was in slavery to the Egyptians, and yet they multiplied and grew. Israel, when they were removed from their removed from the promised land because of the sins of disobeying God and worshiping other gods, when they moved into other areas, God said, yeah, I'm still going to live and leave a remnant. And they were living so much so that when Ezra and Nehemiah got permission from the ungodly kings to go back and reestablish and set up worship in Jerusalem and rebuild the wall and rebuild the temple, the vast majority of Israelites didn't return to the homeland. They stayed where they were. Why? Because God had blessed them in the midst of an unblessed situation. Oh, God, I felt that one. He will bless you in the midst of an unblessed situation. And the reason he does that is because we are part of his kingdom. And as kingdom citizens, we have kingdom rights. But not just kingdom citizenship and kingdom rights. We have royal rights. For we are heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus. He has adopted us into the family. He has got that. Oh, I just got this hot off the presses. He adopted us and he moved us into the palace. And he moved my room next to Jesus.
Thank you.
We're just not in the kingdom. Oh, God, watch this one, Charles. We're not just in the kingdom. But he's called us to help rule the kingdom under his rulership. And with that in mind, we started our kingdom exploration. God, thank you, Holy Spirit. Didn't have that right before I just said it. Our kingdom exploration. My wife and I, a few years ago during the pandemic, we did, from Dr. Tony Evans, give credit where credit is due. They just honored him at the Bible Museum, the Kingdom Marriage Series with some couples that we've met, and thank God it was a blessing. And so because we are citizens of the kingdom. And so today we're starting our kingdom quest for our youth. And if you want to come by on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m., I'll buy you a book. You don't necessarily need the class to have the book, but it works better in a group. And we're going to have breakfast and have a lot of fun because we're trying to understand who we are in the kingdom so we can access and have and take advantage of all the rights that are available to kingdom citizens. I would hate, it would be ridiculous for me to go on vacation to St. Louis, Missouri and not go up into the St. Louis Arch. It would be ridiculous for me to take vacation and go to Virginia Beach and get in the hotel and look out the window at the beach and say, oh, that's nice, and not experience the beach. Why would I go to Disneyland and not spend time with Mickey? I go to Disneyland, I want to see Mickey, Minnie, Donald.
Seven dwarves.
All seven of them too. Somebody off, go get them. Because I'm there. Why? Because when I purchase my ticket, it is with the understanding that I experience the totality of what they have guaranteed me. I don't care if Mickey need a break. Mickey, keep coming off break now. And so it is in the kingdom of God. We have rights. We have provisions. We have things God has promised to us. The problem is that as believers, we listen to the truth of everyone and everything else other than the truth of God's word. Because the truth of God's word calls us to accountability. And then leads to responsibility. But then we won't find, well, this is what I believe. But I believe that part of the Bible. But I don't believe that part. The problem is that you got to twist the truth. And the twisted truth is twisting up your insides. When I was many years ago when I was younger and I used to partake of alcohol, I had to learn that certain drinks don't mix. You can't drink Coca-Cola and a Mountain Dew with all that sugar and then drink and start sipping on some Wild Irish Rose. Because Wild Irish Rose has a bunch of sugar in it itself. And something down on your inside says this don't go together. And what happens is the euphoria you thought you were going to get from being under the influence of the alcohol turns into sickness. And your whole insides are spinning trying to figure out what's going on. And what happens is you wind up regurgitating all of it, throwing it all up, but also throwing up the food that was good for you that you ate earlier, and now your insides continue trying to throw up what's not there, and you start sweating, and you get a headache, and you get dizzy. Why? Because you twisted the brew that was going in you. And I'm trying to tell you, the point I'm trying to make is that in America, we've twisted the ingredients into the bottle. We're trying to put it in, and we're trying to put square pegs in the round holes and wondering why they don't fit and why is the hole cracking. It's because you're trying to hammer something in that should not fit. And the reason that you're unhappy, the reason that you're so stressed out, the reason you're so bogged down is because you don't want the truth. You want your truth, and you want God to change his truth to your truth. So you can be happy with your truth, but you will not be happy with truth until you find the truth of God's word. And so the government says we need to throw more money at mental health. No, you don't need to throw more money at mental health. You need to get on the right health kick. Oh, they have so many mental
mental problems. Oh, he's just always been like that fighting at school. No, when he was 2 years old, and every time you went to your brother's house and he wanted to fight his little brother, or he wanted to pull the girl's hair, and you didn't go like this, Johnny, stop. You didn't go like this and said, I done told you to stop one time. Now he got ADHD. Now he got all of these wrong. No, when a good behind whooping would have drove the devil out of him. And now you done fed into that garden. You done fertilized it. You done put manure on it. And now you got a mess. On our hands, not just yours. Because you don't come to your house and act like that because you give him what he wants. Then when he come here and we say no, now we got to put him in the chokehold. Yeah. All because you wouldn't find, all because the truth of God's word that said spare the rod, spoil the child. The truth of God's word said if you beat him, he will not die. Do you not know when the Bible talks about fathers correcting their children? Do you not know in Bible days, they weren't just talking about little kids. If they was 20-something and got out of line, the father would get the rod and correct them. Why? Because you embarrassing me. And I didn't send you out here to act like this. And you're messing up our future generations and all that we've built and established. I don't know how I got all the way over there. But the truth of God's word will bring us into a place where we can find peace. I want to talk today with Psalms 91, a very familiar passage of scripture to Bible believers and those that pray over their family. But I want to talk about the power, the protection, the provision of the secret place. See, and I may be guilty of this too. But see, the secret place, God dropped this on me this morning. It's only a secret between you and God that the devil doesn't know. It's not a secret that God wants to hide from us. But it's a secret place in him where we can go and the devil can't go. But the secret place is oftentimes in plain sight. The secret place, Thompson, would be when my mother's mother wanted me to be walking around the house. I didn't know she wasn't feeling good. And wanted me to be walking around going like this. Can't no graveyard hold this body down. Can't no graveyard hold this body down. I forgot the rest of the words, but somehow she get to the point that it's something. When he comes around, I'ma get up out of the ground. Can't no graveyard hold this body down. What she was doing, she was in her secret place looking out to the devil and telling him, you don't have the final say so. The writer here in Psalms 91, some say it was David, some say it was Moses, some say David wrote it after the fiasco of 2 Samuel, where he told the captain of the army to go number the people, and God sent the plague. And others say that Psalms 91, or the whole fourth section of the book of the book of Psalms, was psalms written by Moses and other people that had lived through the wilderness experience. Whichever the case is, the song is a song that reminds us of God's power, his protection, and his provision in the secret place. So let's just say it was written by Moses while they were in the wilderness. No one wants to go through the wilderness. But if I can go through the wilderness in the midst of the secret place, the wilderness loses a lot of its impact. because I'm not looking at the wilderness, but I'm looking at the secret place that moves me through the wilderness. The writer here says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He, the individual. Yes, we ought to lead our families and our church to prayer and into relationship with God. But as individuals, we got to be able to find ourselves in the secret place of the Most High, under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress and my God. In Him will I trust. I will say, He is my refuge. When I'm running from the enemy, when something is chasing me, when things are all against me, a refuge is a place of safety where I can't find any other safety. But then He says, He's my fortress. A fortress means I'm going into battle. Refuge is for safety. The fortress is for battle. Meaning the enemy can only come so far. And he has to meet, watch this, he might have to meet my defense line. That's why in ancient times you hear them talk about the walls of the city, the walls of the city, the walls of the city. Because why? Because the walls were meant to protect the people within the city. He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. He's my hiding place. This little song that says, hide me. Because sometimes you and I may not have the spiritual wherewithal, we may not have the faith at that time to deal with that present situation. And God says, get into the secret place. Let me hide you till you get it together. Mm-hmm. My mama used to have a saying, a good runner is better than a bad stand. Mm-hmm. I remember that thought came into my mind. Rob Fife, 11th grade, 6'5". 225, defensive lineman. Wound up playing at the University of New Hampshire. We at the park. Rob Pfeiffer got a problem because his girlfriend was best friends with my best friend Leroy, but her daddy didn't like Rob. So me and Leroy would be over there with his girlfriend, we walking through whatever, and the boy would call, and the girl named Cleavon, and her daddy would answer the phone, talking about, I don't know if she'd come to the phone right now, because she in there with Randy and Leroy.
Really?
Because her daddy didn't like him. So we get to the park, he wants to fight. And I'm like, I can't go out like a punk, Chauncey. I'm Randy James. We ain't going out like that. As small as I am, where I grew up was, if you run from one, you're going to have to run from all of them.
Yeah.
And so I tell them, I'm thinking what to do. And my thought came in my head, my mama could run better than a bad stand. I said, I tell you what, you meet me in 30 minutes at my house. You meet 30 minutes, he did the wrong thing there. He said, all right, I'll meet you in 30 minutes. I got 30 minutes now to try to think of something. Mm-hmm. But what I knew was when I got home, I had safety and security, and because when I got home, I knew Gary was there, I knew I had a hiding place just in case I needed it too. See, we think we're so smart. The devil is an eternal being. We don't know when God created him. We don't know how many years he got on us, but yet we figure we're smart and we can outsmart him. I can outworship him. I can outpraise him. But outthink him. I can outtalk him now. Oh, yeah, you can. You can outtalk him because all you got to do is put the word on him. And when you put the word on him, he got to go.
Yeah.
Surely he shall deliver me from the snare of the fowler. You ever watch that on TV? You'll see they lay traps for a bird. And the bird unknowingly goes and trying to get some, to get a worm or get some water and get caught. The writer here is saying, he shall deliver me from the snare of the fowler. Doesn't mean that I'm not going to get caught. It says, when I get caught, I'll get delivered. I know y'all thought that meant that the snare won't get me. No, what God is saying, some of y'all are too big-headed and you're too pig-headed and you're going to get caught up anyway. I know you just left choir rehearsal. I know you just got back from intercessory prayer, but you're subject to get caught up. And he said, but if you get caught up, I'm going to deliver you. Look at this power of God. The devil cannot hold you in whatever trap. Oh, I hear you, Holy Spirit. I don't care what trap the devil has laid for you. I don't care what situation that you're in. I don't care if you're a drunk, you're a prostitute, you're used, gay, straight, up, down, left, and right. Whatever he has trapped you in, I come to tell you that God has a way of escape. If you trust in him, he will bring you out. There is no lock that he can't pick.
Thank you.
No bars that he can't melt.
Yeah.
No doors that he can't open. No hole so deep he can't pull you up. No high so high he can't pull you down. He wants to come to your rescue. And as a matter of fact, sometimes he lets you get caught so he can show up. If nobody ever got in trouble, Clark Kent would never change in the suit. He says, he shall deliver me thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence, calamity sweeping, the pestilence. Some of y'all, you was 25 years ago, you was afraid to go outside because the AIDS gonna get you. Then it was SARS, now it's COVID. COVID is really another version of SARS, SARS virus. And there'll be others. He says, but he's going to deliver me from the noise of pestilence. It don't mean the pestilence ain't coming. The fact, though, that he's going to deliver me from it, I have to have the opinion of, let it come. Because I'm dwelling in the secret place. Bring it on. Because, see, when it comes, it got to get to him before it gets to me. And if he can handle it, I don't have to worry about it. The problem is, we keep going like this. Let me see what's going on, Jesus. Let me see if I can handle this one. And he goes, go on with your bad self. To deliver me from the noise of pestilence, he shall cover thee with his feathers. And under his wings thou shalt trust. Cover. You ever see a bird, a mother bird with little birdies, and covering and protecting them under the feathers? From the storm and from the wind and from the rain. And if you watch the little birdie, they just snuggle up underneath there. They don't know enough about what's going on. They don't understand weather. They don't understand predators and things like that. Only thing they understand is I got to stay right here in this wind.
Yeah.
That's all they understand. There's something about being right here. I don't know. Something. That's why we spoil babies, because they get used. They say, oh, there's something about being right here. We have to put them down and let them cry out of it, because they know there's something about being right here. That's why you get 35 years old, 40 years old, you go to your mama's house and you lay across her bed. Because there's something. Right now, 57 years old, there is a quilt, Chauncey, that was kind of wool on one side, different kind of greens. It had little red threads pulled through it. like yarn pulled through it. The other side was a material that stayed cool. I wish I could find that blanket from Mummy House. I would pay money for it, AJ, right now. Because it was something about getting that blanket. And she had a big old furnace in the floor. It looked like it was about 4 feet by 4 feet to heat the place. And you would roll up next to it. I don't care what was going on. All you knew is everything was okay because you was under the wing. Couldn't nobody. I could do all kinds of mess. My mama couldn't beat me if my grandmama didn't let her when I was under her wing in her house. Don't get me wrong. Mommy can tie one on every once in a while, too. Now, don't get me wrong. Don't let the sweetness fool you. And she had one of them anointings that when she got hot with you, she grew. At least in my mind, she grew. She looked like when she started talking, you know, because most times she walked leaned over to get old. But when she was stood up like this, the class she put on about 4 inches, AJ. Scared me and my cousin, Well, nothing we could go. We trapped by the sofa in the window. All I knew, she said, raise your voice up in here one more time. Wow. But it was something about being under that wing. That's why the devil tries to destroy family, because the family is supposed to be likened unto our relationship with him. And because big mama's trying to be little mamas, our babies miss the affection, the attention, and the mothering that they should be getting to understand their relationship with God. He said, his wings shalt thou trust, and his truth shall be thy shield and thy buckler. His truth shall be thy shield. His truth will be thy shield. His truth will be thy shield. I wish I knew what I'm saying. His truth will be thy shield, which means I don't care how many lies they come up with, invent, manipulate, grow, produce, they cannot come nigh you because he is my shield. His truth. All you got to do is, what's the name? All you do is take their truth, throw it up against his truth. See what's left standing.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's the problem right there. Don't nobody, that's why people get mad at you when you bring up the scripture, because their truth can't stand in the face of it. It's the same thing that if the devil starts messing with you, you said, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. He got to go. He can't stand that name. And their truth, little t, I'm going to start saying this now. Their truth, little t, cannot stand up to his truth, big T. And what happens is they don't want you to bring up the big T so I can have all my little t's. Because I don't care how many little t's you got, it ain't a capital T. And a small T can't lead off a sentence, only a capital T can.
That's right.
And the problem is, you're formulating opinions, you're formulating paragraphs, you're formulating sentences, and you have improper grammar because the word that you're trying to put at the front, that's why the computer keep putting a red line underneath of it. It's not that the word is spelled wrong, but you have the wrong letter at the beginning because it won't line.
No. That's so good, sir. Say so.
We live in lives of red lines under us.
Wow.
I was in school, and I've gotten a little bit better, but I'm still not great at it with my grammar. I don't know who, Microsoft, whatever, when they invented Word to check your grammar. They were thinking about Randy J.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it was.
Autocorrect.
In the name of Jesus. They was thinking about getting autocorrect too. Woo. Yes. She just brought me back. Woo. She put a mic on you now. But when it lets you know, watch this. It don't always tell you the error, but it tells you something is not right. Yeah. Now watch this. It will still let you print the document with the error. But it's not responsible for the error because it told you what the error was. I come to tell you, God will tell you what the truth is, but you can still hit print if you want to.
Mm-hmm.
talk, sir.
And if you hit print, then you're responsible for the document produced in your life. Now you have a choice. Go back, get it right, and what you printed off, take it to the shredder. Woo! That's good preaching right there. I don't care what y'all say. Yeah, that's good right there. He says, his truth should be that shield and that buckler. Buckler holds it together. When everything else is going away, you need something to hold it together. But watch this. That's his power. It's power in the word of God. Power in the truth of God's word. That's why they don't want you to speak it. Because see, the truth of God's word identifies all lies in everyone else's words.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have no notes up here. I like that one. The truth of God's word identifies lies in everyone else's words. Mm-hmm. But then not only does being in the secret place have power, there is protection. It's protection. He says this. He says, watch this. Fifth verse. He says, thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor for the arrows that flieth by noonday. I've met people before. Some of them are older. Some of them have been through traumatic things. Some of them have been through nothing. They're just scared of being outside at night. And then I've read psychology books where people, they just petrified when it get dark. You go by the house at 12 o'clock at night, and more lights on, the menu power, people putting their kids through college messing with them. Mm. They got lights all outside. And they forget something in the car, unless it's a child, maybe a child, they only own. Because they're that afraid of the dark. Right here he says, we don't have to be afraid of the terrors, of the things that'll happen at night, nor for the arrows that fly at noonday. Sometimes stuff hits you when you're not even expecting it.
Yeah.
In the midst of a nice day, everything going along, all of a sudden, choo, 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 choo. What I like about this right here, it doesn't say that you and I noticed the terror by night, that we saw the arrows during the day. It just says he's going to protect us. Because as believers, we walk around sometimes unaware of everything going on around us. We're supposed to have spiritual discernment. Supposed to have heavenly spidey senses. Like Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Something wrong. But see, just like Spider-Man, you can turn them off and not pay attention to them.
Wow.
We was watching Spider-Man.
No Way Home.
And Spider-Man brought all these characters from the multiverse or whatever. One of them was a Green Goblin. And he said, "This, you just got it. Some of you need to see it then. You get off the computer game and watch the movie. But watch this. So in the midst of Spider-Man trying to help them get rid of their bad nature and things like that, while he's working on it, he doesn't sense that the Green Goblin is really working against him. And when he notices it, watch this, it's too late. We gotta get our spiritual discernment up. We gotta get in the word. We gotta get some praise and worship music going on. We gotta get into some prayer. Ask God, turn up the volume. Turn up. We need to clean off our antennas. Maybe you need to do like the old folks. Maybe you need to put some more aluminum foil on them to get a better signal. I'm speaking spiritually. We're so distracted and so focused on everything else. Look, everything is not God's going to bless you with a new car, a new house, and all that stuff there. If he keeps my mind another week, to God be the glory. Because sometimes I feel like a nut. Sometimes I don't. And we want a tangible blessing to make us feel right when he says, if you just get with me, you'll be right. And all the other stuff, they just sprinkles on the ice cream. Six verse, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wastes at noonday. He says, I'm going to protect you. I'm going to keep you. Night is often a time of many terrors, many robberies and murders and evils. Things happen at night. But he's saying, don't worry about that. Now, don't get me wrong. All things being equal, let's not be fools. Be careful. Let me just say, you can just go do anything. Go out in the middle of the mall parking lot at 12 o'clock in the morning, take your money out, start sitting in the trunk counting it. Let's do some wisdom here. But we're talking about when you're living and doing what you're supposed to be doing, you don't have to worry about, can I just be just transparent for a moment? I just be transparent for a moment. And I have to deal with the devil with this one. Our home, I thank God for it. But our home, we have our front door is about 80%, or 90% glass. We have glass on the sides. And the devil trying to tell me, well, if somebody just kicked the glass at it, come like that. And he even one time was trying to figure out if I had a gun, I could lay right here like this through the railing, and I could pick them off when they come in the house. I said, can't nobody come up in here. I said, matter of fact, I told him one night, I said, matter of fact, why don't you get the hell out? I told him just like that. And roll over and hug my wife. You better start talking. You better talk more than he talking. Because the one thing he got mouth. Yeah. Ask Adam and Eve, he got mouth.
Yeah.
He got mouth.
Compliments
on stuff. And everything he said is a lie. How do you say? Why do I say that? You say, well, when he talked to Jesus, he didn't lie to Jesus. No, partial truth is a lie. Because if you read the original versions of the sentences of the scriptures that he was quoting to Jesus, he didn't quote the whole thing. So he lied. The Bible says he was a liar from the beginning. Now, that's a whole theological class we got to have, because if God created him and he created him as a high angel, an anointed cherub, but he says he was a liar from the beginning, what is he talking about? The beginning of his fall or the beginning of his creation? I don't know the answer to that one right there. All I know is if he's a liar, he's a liar. Liar, 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 pants on fire. My mama used to say, I don't care what they do, you can't believe a liar. It's just in him. It's just natural for him. My mama would say something, even when they get saved, you got to check what they say. She said, Lord, working on me. But watch this protection. Even with all of this going on, you don't have to be afraid of the arrows by day and the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh. That means people are going to fall over and situations are going to fall apart and you're going to be standing right there. And it's for the testimony. That's why the Bible says that ye are the light of the world, a city set upon a hill. Reason being, because everything else that fell off the hill but you. You sitting there in your rocking chair. They tell me how you did it. Sit down. Let me tell you. It's another day that the Lord has kept me. No, but Randy, how did you get through? It's another day that the Lord has kept me. Because see, a lot of this stuff, as believers, can I tell you something? Stop trying to explain everything God doing. You can't, because if you can figure it all out and explain all the details of it, then somebody gonna try and come and repeat the details that you gave them to get the success you got. But then when they don't get it, now they mad at you and God because they figured it would work for them. No, tell them you need to get in the secret place. Yeah. So I was in the secret place one day, and God said, "Look at your shirt pocket," and it was there. Well, what did you do? I got in the secret place. Matter of fact, when I went in the secret place, I didn't go in there looking for that. I tell you what, if we get in the secret place with God, looking for God more than looking for stuff, we'll get more stuff than we went in there looking for.
Yeah, that's good.
I gotta finish this up. Thou shalt fall unto 10,000 in the right hand, it shall not come nigh. It shall not come nigh thee. Only with thy eyes shalt thou behold it and see the reward of the wicked. You're gonna see it, but you ain't gonna experience it. But not only that, but the secret place, but then in the secret place also, God provides for us. He said, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither any plagues come nigh thy dwelling. I didn't remember that scripture that night the devil was messing with me. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. When you land in the bed, snore again, get a old deep sleep and say, God, they can't come nigh my dwelling. Thank you for your provision. Thank you for your protection. Thank you for your power. I'm going to sleep on this one. He said, the angels shall keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. That means that they got to move you to protect you. They'll slide you out of the way. They'll move you and say, I got this. I got this. Stop trying to get in fights that's just not your fight. They'll move you and protect you and keep you. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample on the feet. You're going to step on some poisonous stuff and it's not going to affect you. We keep trying to avoid the lions, tigers, and bears. And oh my, God says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. We keep trying to find a way out of that. What's the name? You know the cobra you work with. You know the viper you work with. Let's say, good morning. God bless you. How you doing today? How you doing today? Pray for you get in there and sanctify your ears. Oh, God bless you. Oh, I had a wonderful weekend. Even if your weekend was turned upside down, I had a wonderful weekend. First of all, you had a wonderful weekend because you made it to the next weekday. So you're still alive. So it's been wonderful. Ask the person that's in the hospital, that's on the respirator. Ask the person that's at Forest Lawn Cemetery. They'll tell you it's a wonderful day. It's a wonderful day. It's a wonderful day in the neighborhood. And when you see them, just keep on moving it. Why? Because you got the power, you got the protection, and you got the provision. I don't need. I don't need your validation. I don't need your authority. I don't need your promotion to get what I got to get from God. Because it's not contingent upon you. Matter of fact, you keep messing with his child, you may be unemployed. I'm just trying to tell y'all. God has not forgotten about his people. God is looking for the people that are still willing to stand up, that are still willing to cry loud and spare not, that are still willing to be humble, that are still willing to be persecuted and be manipulated. And when he shows up, God's going to turn some jobs and shake them up and shake them like they shake children. And God, what you doing? I'm shaking everything out of here that was bothering my children. They're going to be all falling out. You're going to be sitting there. I believe it was sister, we used to go to crusade with her one time. And the job was an upheaval. And she said sometimes she would cry, going home, whatever. And they was in the job and everything was going wrong one day. And people was getting mad. She didn't know what was going on. They were getting mad because they was walking around putting pink slips on people's desks. And they put some on the left side of her. And they put some on the right side of her. They put some in the other cubicle. And they was putting them on desks. They put some on the supervisor's desk. But they was putting them on desks of people that had been there way longer than she had been there, that knew more of the job than she knew. She said, she was just sitting there saying, Jesus, you know I need this job. She said the tears started falling down her eyes. And so she was like, this Lord, I don't know. She said, you stop working, just close her eyes. And then when she looked up, them people was packing their stuff up and going. Thousands shall fall at thy side. 10,000 at thy right hand, but it won't come nigh thee. Your business, that business can't close long as you're there. They can't close long as you're there. No, it's not because God favoring them, because he's favoring you. Watch this. I gotta go. So stop trying to avoid all the hassles. Walk on the adder. Now, you see a snake in the yard tomorrow, get the hoe and chop them up. And that's what I'm talking about. We're talking about in the spirit. But don't keep avoiding things, avoiding the way God has for you to go when you're under his shadow. All of us are seeing this. Mother be like, go over there, tell the little child, go over there to Uncle such and such. They be like, they don't go, but they hug onto their leg and say, I'll go with you. And they just hold onto the leg. Parent got to walk like this, like their leg stiff, and the baby is holding on. Why? Because the baby is safe and secure. God said, that's the way I'm picking you through situations. Hold on to me. Stay in the secret place. Stay under my wing. Stay under my skirt. Let me cover you. Let me keep you so I can transport you to your next level. Don't worry about the person on the other end there. Don't worry about the situations. Though I am with you, lo, even all the way to the end of the world, if they've already killed Jesus and he rose on the third day, they can't kill him again. And so if you can't kill him, you can't kill me. That's just a secret place. Secret place. See, you got to get in the secret place. You know, there's something that I started doing this week, Johnson, for myself, because I want to get in the secret place like never before. Even as a pastor, there's a whole lot of songs that we sing, popular songs. I don't know all the words to them. So if I'm having my moments of meditation and I'm trying to sing a little song in my worship time or whatever, a lot of times I'm repeating the same verse because I don't know the whole song. So I'm taking one song a week and I'm singing it every day. At work, I bring the words up to make sure I got it. And I make sure, and I keep going over and over the same song again. I got one song, it was on my computer. The thing, it plays the same song for 4 hours. Now, I didn't listen to it all 4 hours. But everyone, I took a break. I let it play all the way through, and I read the words over and over again. Why? Because I'm trying to get in the secret place. I'm trying to get in the secret place. Because even though the secret place is a secret to those on the outside, it shouldn't be a secret to me. And if it's a secret place, he got some secrets in the secret place for me that are secrets for me that he wants to reveal to me. So I need to get in there to get my secrets. I need to get in there, and I need to get the secret code. I remember we was kids, and cereal boxes, they don't do it like this anymore, but cereal boxes would come with prizes in them. And one of them, they had a magic decoder ring. And they had little cards, and when you read the cards, you couldn't really read it. But if you got the magic decoder ring, and you took the ring and slid it over it like that, you could read it. And Johnson, we would get the brand new box of cereal, open it up, get your mom's biggest mixing bowl, and pour all the cereal out of the bag, into the bowl, because I wanted to get the secret decoder ring. Why? Because I wanted to decode the messages. I'm telling you right now, God is saying, it's time for you to open up some cereal boxes, dump all the mess out, dump all the sugar out, get all the paper out so you can get the decoder ring, because I got messages for you. I got a word for you. I got a promotion for you. I got directions for you. But you got to get in the secret place to get the secret messages, because I can't reveal it to everyone. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit, just dropped in my spirit. In the secret places are secret messages for God's people, but you can't get my message and I can't get yours. Because your secret message is for you and my secret message is for me. So I need to get my magic decoder ring. Baby, when we leave here, we got to stop by the grocery store because I got to get me some Lucky Charms so I can get my magic decoder ring.
Amen.
Watch this. 14th verse, we're going. Because he has, why do I have his power? Why do I have his protection? Why do I have his provision? Why do I have access to his secret place? Because he has set his love upon me. No, not because I'm all that good looking. I am, but I ain't that good looking. No, not because I'm not that great. No, because he loves And that ought to be enough to let you know that the creator of the universe, regardless where you've been, regardless what you've done, regardless who you are, he's in love with you. And guess what? He got the I can't help it. He's like the prophet with Gomer. He goes out to the slave market and says, though she's cheated on me, I see Larry Moe and Curly. I see them babies that don't look like me. But when I see her, my heart is encapsulated. That my heart is intertwined. And I can't help myself. Jesus said, Father, I know you're in love with him. I see the pain in your heart, God. Every time you look at them, he said, prepare me a body, and I'll go down and redeem your love back to you. I know you're hurting, Father. He says, if I got to die so that you can get your love back, so let it be. Because he set his love upon you. Therefore, he says, will I deliver him? He says, not only you're going to be delivered when you get in the secret place, he said, but I'm going to set you on. He said, I've set him on high. Deliverance and promotion while hiding in the secret place. That's contradictory to everything we do in America. Deliverance and promotion while you're hiding in the secret place. Because, why? Because we know his name. And he says this, talking about us. He shall call upon me. He says, I will answer him. And I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him, watch this, and honor him. We give honor to God. But God says, when you get in the secret place, he says, I'm going to honor you. What does it look like when the God of all creation honors the creation that turned their back on him? Oh, that's mind-blowing. That's mind-blowing for me. He says, I'll honor him. And finally, with long life, will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. With long life, will I satisfy him. That don't mean, to me, what that means is, not only are you going to have a long life, he said, will I satisfy him? That means you're going to have a long, healthy life. Because there are many people that live a long life, but they, you know, different things or whatever, but I'm believing that I can be 80 and get around.
Yeah.
They do like Papa West, driving. Uncle Freddie said, Uncle Freddie, just something about a 90-year-old man driving me around. Uncle Freddie was in his 50s then. He said, just something, 60s, just something about a 90-year-old man riding, yeah, driving me around. You riding with him?
That's your daddy.
Take care of myself. He says, long life will I satisfy him. And what that means is, if I got long life and he satisfied me, Chauncey, I ain't worried about no bills in my old age. I ain't worried about no sicknesses. I got what I need and I got a little extra. Papa West said, one of a friend of his that had passed away and his daughter wasn't available, nobody available to take him to the funeral, he said, I'll take it myself. Cops stopped him, told the cops, yeah, every time I get in here, this car moves faster. Asked him, man, where you going? I'm going to a funeral. Told me, you have a good day. Sometimes you got to use your age. He said, long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. So I'm saved. I know I'm saved. I believe my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life and go home to be with Jesus when he comes back. But he says, not only am I saved, but he's going to show me his salvation. That just blows my mind. I don't know what you said. There's power, there's provision, there's protection, and there's provision in the secret place. But you got to get into the word to get into the secret place, to learn what the secrets are. The secrets, you can't go to the door and get the secrets. You can't stand in a parking lot. No, there's no drive-through. You have to, and the part I jump right over, please forgive me. He said, for going back, he said, he that dwelleth. That dwelleth means to take up residence. It means to pitch your tent. It means it's not a hotel. You're not staying for a few days. Meaning that I've come to occupy. It's not a quick stop. It's not a drive-through. It's it's not something you just. It's not an outpatient clinic. You got to stay here a little while. We got to run tests on you. We got to do some procedures on you in the secret place. Watch this. We get into the secret place, and we pitch our tent, we build our boat, we build our home, we make our abode in there, and we sit down in there, we give God time to work on us. Because some of us are not ready for the secrets when we get in the secret place, because we'll mess it up. So he said, I need you to sit here for a little minute, for a little while. I need you to come to these classes. Yeah, I need you to come. I need you to come to choir rehearsal. And God, I can't sing now, but I still need you to come to choir rehearsal. I need you to sit here. I need you to practice these songs. I need you to practice this word. I need you to read it over and over and over again. The secret is right there in that particular scripture. And you're like, Lord, I've been reading this same scripture over and over and over again. My wife got a thing that the Lord gave her some numbers. Keep seeing it over and over again. Just stay in the secret place. To stay in the secret place. It allowed to be a combination to something he had. And then, oh, she may be a date coming up. I don't know. That's her secret. That ain't my secret. But in the secret place of God, the secrets of God are revealed to his people. But the first thing you got to do is you got to have access to the secret place. And the way you have access is song. Way you have access to the secret place, music. The way you have access to the secret place is that you got to get in the face of God. You got to fall down on your knees. You got to say, dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. I believe that you lived and you died for my sins and the sins of the world. I believe the Father sent you and that you died on the cross for my sins and the sins of the world. And now you rose again and you're seated at the right hand of the Father. And so now, Jesus, I ask you to come be my Lord and Savior. I repent for all of my sins and shortcomings. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. I come to you now, Jesus. I ask you to save me now. I ask you to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords of my life. I give you the glory for it right now. I accept you as my Savior. Come into my heart now. I repent for all my sins and shortcomings. Blot out my iniquities and my transgressions. Save me now, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, if they prayed that prayer, God, I ask you to save them now. Sanctify them. Fill them with the gift of your Holy Ghost. Lead them to a Bible teaching, believing church. Speak to them during the day and during the night. Let them know that they're saved, that their name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. We thank you for it right now, God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Thank you, God. Amen and amen. And if you prayed that prayer, let me help you. Let me disciple you. Let me put something in your hand to help you grow in the knowledge of the Lord. Would you message me and hit me up and just send me your address? And no strings attached. It's just a book to help you grow in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Would you do that? I would be so excited. And just let us know that you gave your life to the Lord. And let us help you find a Bible-believing church If you're in the Tri-City area, you're welcome to come here to the River of God, 3833C South Creighton Road, Petersburg, Virginia. Or if you want to help finding another church, we'll help you there too. Because we just want you to be in relationship with God, growing in the knowledge of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May God bless you is my prayer. I pray the word of God has been a blessing for you. Read Psalms 91 this week before you go to bed. Read your daily Bible reading. We have material here to help you in your daily time you spend with the Lord. Remember, there's power, there's protection, there's provision in the secret place. Get in the secret place with God. Get in the secret place with God. You get in the secret place with God, watch this. You won't have to worry about the government. You don't have to worry about the Supreme Court. You won't have to worry about the gas prices. You just put your faith and confidence in Him and watch what God will do in your life. May God bless you is my prayer. Till Wednesday night for our Bible study, we're going to be talking about the atonement of Jesus Christ. May God bless you and how that's a blessing in your life. May God bless you is my prayer. Till we meet again. God bless you. Bye-bye. All right, how can we get that music quicker?